part one, we debunked Jarrah's claim that a false color image from the space.com article proved that the LRO photo of the Apollo 15 landing site was a fake. The black spot in this image indicates an abundance of iron oxide in the area surrounding the Apollo 15 landing site, something that you cannot detect in the LRO photo or in any visible light surface photos taken by the Apollo astronauts in the same area. So next, Jarrah turns to an article from the JAXA website, the Japan Aerospace Exploration Agency. In that article, they say that a bright area photographed by their Selene Kaguya spacecraft, what they call a potential halo, was made brighter by the lunar module's descent plume. At least that's what I think it says. That seems to be Jarrah's interpretation as well. Like the space.com article, this one is poorly written, and as an added bonus, it's in broken English. I read it over 20 times, and I'm still not exactly sure what it says. Anyway, in response to this photo, Jarrah boldly states, as fact, that if the bright spot was caused by the descent plume, the lunar module should obviously be somewhere inside the halo. Then he demonstrates by cleverly switching back and forth between various photos that the lunar module in the LRO photo is on the edge of the halo area, not inside it. Jarrah then says that the halo in the Selene Kaguya photo corresponds exactly with where the, what he calls the large impact craters are located. I'm not really sure what he means by that, but logically then, in Jarrah's mind, there is no way this halo had anything to do with the descent engine's plume. Jarrah then concludes that due to the overwhelming evidence, what NASA claims is the lunar module in the LRO photo is either a boulder or it was composited into the image. Right. Actually, I have to applaud Jarrah's logic in this case. It's excellent. The lunar module should be in the middle of the disturbed area. I fully agree with that. Well, actually, it depends on how close they were to the surface while they're riding in. They were moving about 45 feet per second horizontally while descending 2 to 3 feet per second vertically, so the disturbance area could actually be teardrop-shaped. But for simplicity, let's assume it's circular and that the lunar module should be in the center. Before we award Jarrah a point for his observation, I want to examine another item briefly mentioned in the Clementine article. Let's look at an old photo, something Jarrah knows exists and failed to comment on, the Apollo 15 pan camera frame 9377. This was taken by astronaut Alfred Warden while riding in the command module Endeavour at about 100 miles above the landing site. According to NASA, this photo was taken about an hour after the end of the stand-up EVA. By the way, Jarrah actually uses camera frame 9377 twice in his video. A high-resolution detail of this photo shows the area immediately around the lunar module. The solar elevation was about 10.5 degrees to the east, as is evident by the cast on the inside of nearby craters. You see a bright area just south of the lunar module, similar to the halo in the JAXA photo, but wait a minute. This bright area looks different than the JAXA photo. How can that be? This composite image, direct from the NASA studios, compares the detail from the Apollo 15 pan camera frame 9377 and the Selene Kaguya image. It shows that in the Apollo image, the western portion of the crater interior is bright, while in the Selene Kaguya image, the eastern portion is bright. We're lighting up two different sides of the same crater. Sunlight is coming in from the east in the Apollo image and from the west in the Selene Kaguya image. So we've got a crater. And if Selene Kaguya had taken their photo during the lunar morning instead of late in the lunar afternoon, would the halo have moved to the west? If you follow any kind of logic, then yes, it would. What the folks at JAXA theorize is that the surface layer throughout the crater was brightened by the lunar module engine plume, not just the part that was in sunlight at the time the photo was taken. The shape of this crater becomes more evident in Apollo 15 pan camera frame 9798, taken about 40 hours later, shortly after the second EVA. This photo shows the landing site and crater in more direct sunlight. Actually, this photo not only shows the lunar module and a significantly shorter shadow, but also the lunar rover, disturbed regolith where the astronauts had walked around the lunar module, and a footpath out to the ALSEP, the Apollo Lunar Surface Experiment Package. Of course, the major factors affecting the apparent brightness of a crater interior are the slope of the crater wall and the angle of sunlight. They don't mention that in the article, but then it's rather obvious, so why should they? I think this explains why the lunar module is not in the middle of JAXA's halo, but if it's not intuitively obvious to the most casual hoax conspiracist, let me elaborate a bit. you don't have to land directly in the middle of a crater to stir up the dust. If the lunar module flew anywhere in the vicinity of the crater, the engine exhaust could cause dust to scatter down one side of the crater and up the other. This doesn't mean dust is blowing out of the crater, although it could. I'm sorry, is that confusing? This dust scattering redistributes a very thin top layer of regolith. Basically, it's just smoothing out and recompacting the dust. Now, the only way you can really check JAXA is if you have access to their data, which they don't provide in the article. To prove the crater is actually brighter, you have to compare the mean luminance value of this crater to similar craters in the area under similar lighting conditions. We don't have that. But so what? How is any of this related to the LRO photo? What do we see in this photo? From the cast in the nearby craters, the sunlight is obviously coming in at a low angle from the west. There are light and dark areas just below the lunar module, indicating the presence of a shallow crater. The light area in the LRO photo corresponds to the halo in the JAXA photo because the sunlight's coming in from the same direction in both photos. So what does all this prove? Even if you don't buy the bit about the dust being stirred up in the crater, you have to admit that JAXA found the same crater that you see in the LRO photo. So how does this prove the LRO photo is fake? Does it prove that what NASA claims is the Apollo 15 descent stage in the LRO photo is actually a boulder or the swipe of a pen in Photoshop? No, it doesn't. All it proves is that JAXA found a crater, period. But if the descent plume disturbed the dust in the crater, shouldn't the lunar module be in the middle of the crater? No, it just had to fly near the vicinity. And since Scott obviously got two legs of the lunar module in this particular small crater, that's pretty darn close. What's really cool, though, is that Jarrah picked two seemingly unconnected articles to disprove the LRO photo, but in actuality, the two articles are consistent with one another. They back each other up. And contrary to Jarrah's analysis, they both support the LRO photo. In the Clementine article, the black splotch indicating the presence of iron oxide defines a circular area with up to 150-meter radius. Jarrah even points that out. Coincidentally, the crater that JAXA thinks is brighter than other nearby craters is completely contained within this 150-meter radius. I'm actually borrowing a graphic from Jarrah's video for this demonstration, so I hope this scale is correct. But what's most interesting is that if the lunar module is sitting in the middle of the disturbance, then the JAXA halo, which amounts to only 16% of the total area of disturbance, is just off to the side and well within the area of disturbance. So, the JAXA halo, if it exists, ends up being the oh-so-obvious visible sign of a disturbance that Jarrah says should be present based on the false color image. All the inconsistencies that Jarrah found between the two articles appear to be two sides of the same truth. The JAXA argument is now debunked. 2 points, Phil. We're out of time again, so in part three of this series, we will review Jarrah's use of Bill Kaysing's book, We Never Went to the Moon, and excerpts from a Penn Jillette radio show to discredit the LRO photo of the Apollo 15 landing site. Ciao, moon hoax conspirators, wherever you are.